special CNBC TV 18 CII debate igniting India, the agenda for education. I'm Shireen Bhan. The Indian government's education approach has been clumsy and unwieldy. The focus of government in education was on building infrastructure with little emphasis on teachers' training, educational achievement and performance measurement. Education policies have funded schools, not schooling. This passage from Nandanilekani's Imagining India Ideas for a New Century perhaps captures the current crisis in our classrooms. There is some reason for hope, though. Public expenditure on education has seen a fourfold increase in the 11th five-year plan. But the solution to solving this crisis is not political attention and funding, but liberalizing and decontrol. So are we ready for watershed reforms in education? Has the time come to go beyond hypocrisy and political rhetoric? Joining us to discuss these issues, the Minister for Human Resource Development, Kapil Sibal, the Chairman of CII Northern Region, Harpal Singh, the Group Chairman of NIIT, Rajendra Pawar, and the CEO and Managing Director of Milestone Group, Ved Prakash Arya. Gentlemen, many thanks. Okay, Mr. Pawar, let me bring you in because you've heard what Kapil Sibal has had to say in terms of his 100-day agenda, in terms of the national roadmap and the reforms in terms of education. What to your mind is the single biggest priorities, you know, when we talk of liberalizing the sector in that sense?
Well, it's very difficult to put one simple thing, but just to take the ideas that Minister talked about, to take them forward, we have first of all the quantity question.
Yeah.
So if you see the 11th plan document, for higher and technical education, the estimated need is some 250,000 crores.
And the outlay is about 30,000 crores.
And the outlay is about 30,000 crores. It tells us that there is a huge need, and irrespective of how much allocation we want from the government, there's a big gap. So I think we need to recognize these gaps. Now, these gaps are different at different levels.
Hmm.
And the more, as our Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan program begins to fall into place, I think quantitatively it's falling into place, we need to do qualitative improvement. Now the government is rightly saying that let's go to the Madhyamik Shiksha, which is the higher classes. So I visualize when in the night I think of this opportunity or challenge that trainloads of kids coming into middle school,
right,
and we are not ready. So rightly I think government is saying now that's the second big area where we have to gear up like we did Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. And then when these kids go into higher secondary, then that train is going to move ahead into higher education. So I think the all areas need to be dealt with. Now, only point that I would like to make is the right to education, that means to get a child literate, is now we are all agreed, is a responsibility of government. As the child grows and becomes more conscious of choices and reaches either the vocational level or higher education level, it is possible to assign an economic value to that education. If I go and do this diploma, I pay so much, I get a job of so much, I can get a loan. So the economic equation can happen at higher education, and therefore the liberalization at higher education can be much more of involving non-government actors, because the economic model can work. There's a rational, educated customer who's better informed.
Right.
Whereas if you go to school, it's a bit more difficult. So if you have to liberalize, I would say liberalize bottom downward, with the government playing a more and more active role to make sure every child now gets, we are getting them into school. That's happening. That's a great achievement.
But whether they're literate or not is a separate issue, but that's the issue of another debate altogether.
To keep them in school and then carry this work on as you go forward. So at that end, I think government's investments, and the other end, non-formal.
Would you agree, Mr. Sibal, that you